books on the occult had been piled on the table. The room was stacked with light reading, such as Necronomicon, Witchcraft, and Paradise Lost. Old exotic titles like Malleus Maleficarum and Deum Brarum Reini Novum Portus. Books with pentagrams on their covers, all dealing with the occult and the infernal, lying between stacks of horror videos and a couple of Ouija boards. The only thing I could take seriously was the thought of Lupino taking it seriously. He had been spending a lot of time getting intimate with the guy downstairs. The backstage area led to Lupino's inner sanctum. The hot air inside was like an invisible wall, thick with incense and something else, a sickly sweet smell that made you gag. This was the rotten core of the Big Apple. Lupino lurked somewhere ahead, like a spider at the center of his web, waiting. The vapors in the air started to make my head swim. Torn pieces of a letter lay scattered on the sofa. Punchinello had threatened Lupino in writing. The note had been torn to pieces, bloody fingerprints all over it.
Don't want you to think that one of my boys is not playing with a full deck. Shape up, Jack. We are running a business here. I'd hate to send the trio to strong-arm you.
The trio were the Don's notorious henchmen. It was obvious that Lupino hadn't been intimidated by the threat. Lupino's notes covered the table. Jack Lupino was crazy, all right. The table was scattered with notes of demented arcane nonsense written in rusty blood, a mishmash list of demons, devils, and dark gods evoked.
Beelzebub! Asmodeus! Baphomet! Lucifer! Loki! Cthulhu! Lilith! Hera! Blood given to you all.
He was after that old Faustian deal, your soul for power and fortune. Just sign in the dotted line with your blood. Lupino's notebook lay on the pedestal. Jack Lupino was crazy, all right.
Mythic wolves, let loose to devour the sun and the moon. Lupino is the wolf. I'm Mr. Beast, the big bad Fenris wolf. I'm the end of the world man, wearing the flesh of fallen angels.
After Y2K, the end of the world had become a cliche. But who was I to talk? A brooding underdog avenger alone against an empire of evil, out to right a grave injustice. Everything was subjective. There were only personal apocalypses. Nothing is a cliche when it's happening to you.
Thank you.
I had known there'd have to be a catch in it somewhere, and this one was the Empire State Building of catches. Levino was pumped up and dying to go 15 rounds with a mutant alligator. And then he started this spooky monkey talk, straight from a bad dream. Mine.
I have tasted the flesh of fallen angels. I've tasted the devil's green blood. It runs in my veins. I've seen beyond a world of skin, the architecture of blood and bow and arrow. Death is coming!
She is coming, and hell follows with her. This is the twilight winter. I am ready to be her son.
Her time is now, and all who stand in her way must die! Die! You'll die! You'll die! Now! All die!
Finally went down. I wanted to make real sure he'd stay that way. V was a bad monster. Turned them into friggin' zombie demons from outer space.
I think he's dead already.
Huh? And that's when it happened.
But dead or not, you've got the wrong guy.
In stepped this knockout femme fatale holding a gun to my face. I returned the favor. Lisa Punchinello. Lisa Punchinello was the Don's wife.
Mona Sachs. Lisa's evil twin.
Your safety's off, evil twin. You might hurt someone with that gun of yours.
Lisa's the damsel in distress. I'm the professional. I'd blow you away without batting an eye.
Sure, and you can check out my credentials splattered all over this joint.
Jack couldn't have framed you, not the state he was in. We're after the same slime bag. Angelo Punchinello's the one who murdered your friend and framed you with it.
You know this for a fact.
I've got my sources.
I don't have a clue these days. I just shoot them as they come. Who put a contract on the Archfiend?
This one's mine. I hate the guts of that sadistic wife-beater. Why not pool our bullets for this one?
I thought you'd never ask. My finger was starting to twitch.
How do you like your whiskey?
I'm easy, as long as you don't try to slip me a Mickey.
You're a real angel, Max.
It was good stuff. Tasted sweet as honey going down.
Nothing personal. Can't risk you going berserk and getting Lisa killed.
The nightmare was always the same. Violent shapes moving in darkness, old and ugly. The killer's mad laughter was a riddle filled with wicked innuendo. Somewhere, the baby was crying.
Thank you. should have known it when we found you snoring next to Lupino's corpse. A comedian, huh?
The pictures were filled with good old times. Alex and I had a few moments of glory between us. Crime-fighting comrades, the best in NYPD-DEA collaborative team. Good-hearted macho bullshit like that. I would have given anything to have him here as my backup. No such luck. No luck at all. Michelle looked at me. The Payne family. Happiness captured in a Polaroid moment. I had thought it would last forever, till death do us part. I didn't want to think about it. As long as I didn't, it could never happen. But I had broken my own rule. The thought had already slipped in. Fear was rusty needles poking at my brain. Cold and scaly, it slithered down my chest. The photo.
Cartoons. Captain Baseball Bat Boy is my favorite. I really love to watch cartoons. Captain Baseball Bat Boy is my favorite.
No, no, please, God, no.
Vaporize them, disintegrate them. No matter what you do, they'll still be back, good as new.
Michelle's diary lay on the table. Michelle was working part-time in the district attorney's office. Her diary was open on today's entry, her handwriting all pretty curves.
An army dossier found its way to my desk yesterday. Valhalla? Isn't that a Norse myth? Something about Vikings? I tried to tell Max about it, but he was busy, that cute frown on his brow. Guess it's nothing, just a mix-up at the courier service.
From now on, I would always find time for her. It was a hollow promise. Too little, too late. Smiling.
Pleased to meet you. I'm Frankie the Bat Niagara.
Niagara, as in you cry a lot? He had a baseball bat and I was tied to a chair. Pissing him off was the smart thing to do.
Nothing wrong with a little laugh now and then. Take me, for example. I love to watch cartoons. Cartoon violence is a fascinating thing. Let's take a break. I need to take a leak and maybe grab a cold one at the bar. Don't worry. I'll be back to finish this off. And then, it's checkout time.
You play, you pay, you bastard. He swaggered out, and the door clanged shut behind him, locks clicking into place. Everyone makes mistakes. Mine hadn't been to crack jokes about the goon with the bat. He'd have cracked my skull regardless. It hadn't even been to trust a girl with a gun. I had blindly gone after the first bad guy on my hit list when I should have been aiming further up the ladder, at the head of the Punchinello family. I couldn't bring myself to be pissed at Mona. Guess I had a soft spot for a pretty face. When somebody decides to play baseball with your head, you tend to get sore. They had dragged me back to the basement of Lupino's hotel. I was beaten, bruised, and blue. I felt like the chair I had broken to get free. All I had was Niagara's bat, sticky with my own blood. Without a gun, I'd be no match for Frankie's men. I'd have to play hide and seek with them.
We'll take care of it. Hey, here he is.
Bud. Without a gun, I'd be no match for Frankie's men. I'd have to play hide and seek with them. Without a gun, I'd be no match for Frankie's men. I'd have to play hide and seek with them.
Hold it!
What the hell?
Ah!
Another newspaper caption for a murder scene. Frankie had left his calling card, a Captain Baseball Bat Boy strip, next to a sewer passage filled with bodies.
You'd better not mess with Captain Baseball Bat Boy. Even my archenemy, Bicycle Helmet Girl, swoons at the sight of me. Aha!
There were enough corpses to put a mass murderer to shame. Things were fast going from bad to worse. The men in blue had come and gone. They had decorated the place with chalk outlines and tied it together with yellow tape. The cops who had stayed behind were dead. Frankie, his boys, and I had the place all for ourselves.
That crazy witch, you should have heard her. She was a real scream when the boys caught her trying to cap the Don. Oh, that's friggin' bad. To the trio? That's even worse than what Frankie's doing to that poor bastard downstairs. She's gonna take a long time to die.
The mobster muscle on the phone was talking about Mona. Punchinello's trio were nothing but bad news. More evidence that Punchinello didn't like me much.
The fact remains that all the victims so far identified in the Ragnarok shooting have been known criminals, many of whom had large doses of V in their blood. Reliable sources say that Max Payne was also among those killed, although no body has been recovered at this time.
Reliable sources. That meant somebody thought the Mafia had me, didn't want the cops snooping around anymore. The body would be delivered to them barely recognizable. Case closed. Don Punchinello had the power to be that reliable source, which was no news. But his news was old news. Framing me hadn't been enough. Don Punchinello had put a hit on me. He wanted me dead, and it had been important enough for him to give written instructions to Frankie about it.
Max Payne should die like a dog for the trouble he's caused. Frankie, I know I can trust you to give this matter the dedication it needs.
Yo!
The hotel bar was fast developing quite a history. True to his words, Frankie was there, having a beer.
Jesus Christ. How the hell did you get loose?
Got bored waiting. Thought, what the hell, we could just as well finish this here. without.
Thank you. You've been a lovely audience. Had enough?
I don't play with girls anyway.
Unfair!
I spotted the tail as soon as I left the hotel. A big black Mercedes. I'd seen the car before. That time it had heralded impressive explosions. Vladimir was back.
Bang. You're dead, Max Payne.
I might have laughed if I remembered how. What's this supposed to be? Cops and robbers? Look, you want something with me? Get in line.
Peace, man. Relax. You know you are a real news item. Armed and dangerous. I am going to make you an offer you can't refuse. I've always wanted to say that.
It's a bum rap. I've been framed.
Well, that's a moot point. Whatever you did or did not do, I'm sure you had good reason for doing it. Want to hear me out?
I'm listening.
Punchinello messing with V is bad for business all around. But that's not all. There is this guy, Boris Stein, used to pull jobs for me. He's the captain of the cargo ship Charon. Now the bastard turncoat has gone over to the other side, Punchinello's. The ship's loaded with high-res hardware, guns, my business. If Punchinello gets hold of that cargo, he's won and I have lost. And you'll have your work cut out for you. If you want to get to Punchinello, you need heavy-duty persuaders. I am just the man to get them for you. Change the ship back under my flag, maybe pop two in the traitor Dime's head while you're at it. You'll get enough guns to start the apocalypse. You in or out?
Let's get this show on the road. Vladimir was one of those old-time bad guys with honor and morals, which made him almost one of the good guys. None of us was a saint. The Brooklyn riverfront was a maze of rusty containers, shark-boned cranes looming up from the snowstorm. On a night like this, you couldn't help but think of the dark army of dead men sleeping with the fishes, cement shoes in line. No Minotaur lurked in this labyrinth, but somewhere out there, on the clanking deck of his cargo freighter, the skipper of the Charon was waiting, like the ferryman of the River Styx. Cargo freighter. The skipper of the Charon was waiting, like the ferryman of the River Styx. Cargo freighter. The skipper of the Charon was waiting, like the ferryman of the River Styx.